Hi, everyone. It's Plastic EP coming in from Melbourne. Let me tell you, coming in from the UK, I've got Peter Checkfield, right? He's got a fantastic book, and what it's called is Undercover, the Rolling Stones cover 500. It's 500 songs, isn't it? 500 yeah. Cover songs of the Rolling Stones. Is that amazing or what?
They actually covered, they did thousands, literally thousands of covers, but I had to listen to probably about 3,000 and come up with the best 500. So, yeah.
I've got to say, in the UK, you've written so many fantastic music books, and all they have to do is go on the net and check out how many books you've actually written. And, I mean, it's amazing. And you do signings, you sign the book. You're a plethora of information when it comes to the UK music scene. But not only that, you wrote about Shindig. You know a lot about the American ones too, which, you know, I find you're a universal expert on music scene, especially the 60s, even though you've written about the 70s and so on. I just love talking about the 60s. So tell me now, what gave you the idea to write this book and how long did it take to write?
Well, I've been a Rolling Stone. Rolling Stones have always, you know, no disrespects to the Beatles, the Monkees, the Yardbirds, the Kinks, and all these other fantastic groups. But the Rolling Stones in the Brian Jones years have always been my very favourite group. And I've been wanting to write something on them for a while. And I just needed a new angle. And I don't know, I was just listening to some cover versions. I thought, you know, maybe there's a book in this. And probably took me about 9 months from idea to finish. But and I did a lot of interviews, 130 interviews. That took time, so, yeah.
That's unbelievable. Now, I want to talk about Ready, Steady, Go. It was such an important British music show. Tell me what you know about that. Tell me about Michael Lindsay-Hogg being the director and what it was like. Because, you know, that show was so important to the UK young people growing up. What was it? Was it on a Friday night they filmed it? Tell me about it.
Yeah, that's right. It ran from, I believe, the autumn of 63 to the end of 66. And especially in the last couple of years, from 65 to 66, once it went live, you know, it was a fantastic show. And Michael Lindsay-Hogg, you know, his direction. The thing that stands out for me is the Rolling Stones are on it doing Paint It Black. And first of all, there's all bright lights, and gradually, one by one, the lights go out. So by the end of the song, there's just a little spotlight on Mick Jagger and all the studios in darkness. I mean, that was fantastic. This was 1966. This was, 57 years ago. It was incredible, yeah.
I see a red door and I want it painted black. No colors anymore, I want them to turn black. I see the girls go by dressed in their soft clothes. I have to turn the head until my daughter's gone. I see a line of cars and they're all painted black.
I want them to turn black.
I saw the clip of Lulu doing Shout. There's so many great clips in that show. Ready, steady, go.
Her first record is called Shout, and here she is, Lulu.
Well, you know you make me want to shout. Put my hand.
DVD these episodes or not really?
No, only bootlegs, unofficial. No, I remember in the 80s there was three volumes of VHS tapes which had bits and pieces on, and that's what really got me into the show. I was born in 63, so I'm slightly too young to actually remember it, but yeah, those 80s VHS tapes really got me into the show, and yeah, I've loved now, the show. And
who was the female that did the hosting? Was her name McGowan?
Yeah, Kathy McGowan. An icon. Yeah, a fashion icon at the time. Yeah, I can't even think of a modern equivalent. But you know, all the women copied her. Yeah, I think the only one who was up there with her, influential, was Sandy Shaw. I mean, a lot of people copied Sandy Shaw. She always looked very stylish as well. But Sandy Shaw. But and Kathy McGowan. Yeah.
I want to say also when we're doing Shout. I saw the film clip for that. That was a ripper. I mean,
fantastic.
She's great.
That was her very first appearance as well, very first TV appearance. And I mean, she's interviewed on it as well and seems slightly nervous. But when she gets to performing, yeah, she was 15 years old. And just so professional, so confident. I love Lulu. I adore Lulu. I really do. So.
You know that song, I'm a Tiger? That's a beauty. That was a big hit in Australia. I'm a tiger. That was great.
Yeah, I remember it well. That was written by Marty Wild. The 50s legend, Marty Wild. Actually, I've got to tell you, I saw Marty Wild earlier this year in concert, 83 years old, and he sounds like he did in the 50s. Absolutely fantastic. Marty Wild's absolute legend. Yeah.
Now, I'm just saying, the Beatles' appearance on the Ready, Steady, Go show, that was fantastic in 64.
They did three appearances. They did one in late 63 and then a couple in 64. I like the first one in 63. And I don't know if you've ever seen it. Helen Shapiro's doing a song, Look At Me Now.
And, yeah, I and saw they, that. She walks past the Beatles and they turn. There's one Beatle missing, though. Paul's not there.
Paul's there, that's it. I'm trying to think which one was missing. Yeah, that's right. Paul's missing. The other three.
So we got John. He's there. Then we got George. And then we got Ringo. And to me, they come along. They're just like hamming it up during the song. Yeah. And John loves teasing her. You know, I don't want to say anything, but I reckon he teases her so much in that song.
There's a famous bit in you've probably seen this as well on Ready, Steady, Go, and the Beatles are being interviewed by Dusty Springfield, and she says about what's these marks on your face, and she said, are they scabs? And John Lennon turns around and said, show us your scabs. I mean, he had the personality to get away with it. He said these outrageous things, but because John Lennon also had this charisma and charm, he just got away with it. Yeah, so, yeah.
And the great thing is they're wearing the Beatles suits.
I got some questions to ask you here. Please, could you tell me the name of your racing greyhound?
I haven't got one, actually.
You haven't?
No, it's a... Well, a girl sent in a letter to me, and she said, would you like a great... Gracing Rayhound.
Gracing.
And I said, yeah, but she hasn't sent it yet.
She hasn't? Oh. How will she send it to you before? I'm sure she will.
No, she hasn't sent it yet. I hope she does, though. You know.
Oh, it's a great one. Listen. Is it true you sleep with your eyes open?
Well, you know, I haven't seen myself do it, but actually the fellas say that I do.
They do?
You know, they've sort of seen me sleeping with my eyes open.
They really
are.
How can you do that?
I don't know. You know, it's just sort of
half open. Clever. Just brilliant, Paul. Yeah. Please ask Paul if he plucks his well-shaped eyebrows. I think he might. Do you?
No.
You know, and it doesn't look so... No, they're perfectly natural, girls. No, they're absolutely beautiful. Paul, do you mind girls screaming all through your act?
No, really, we like them screaming, generally, all of us, but it's a bit much all the way through.
Yeah.
But we love them screaming.
Yeah.
John, this is a question which you've probably been asked 1,000 times before, but you always, all of you give different versions or different answers. So you've got to tell me now, how did the Beatles get their name?
I just thought of it.
You just thought of it? Another brilliant Beatle.
No, really.
Were they called anything else before?
They called the Quarrymen.
Oh, you rugged character. Oh, John, listen, listen. Do you have false teeth, as they always look so evil? Even?
No.
Even?
They're all chipped and battered.
No. Girls, would you say his teeth were chipped and battered?
No.
No!
No.
They're rather beautiful.
No, they're real.
Lovely teeth.
Is it true that when you were a kid, you were shot at for stealing apples?
Yes, yes.
Is that what these beautiful marks
are? No, they're scabbed.
They're scabbed. Well, let's have a look. Show them your scabs. There's nothing there at all, as he's got a beautiful complexion.
Let me see your scabs. Hey.
Oh, no. I think this is where we better start finishing. What are you going to sing next?
She loves you.
Of course. She does.
To the book, right? Now I've gone through it, and what I want to ask you is, right, it's got something here about Andrew Oldham, his orchestra, right? I want to know more about that, right?
I mean George Martin also, as you know, did albums of Beatles hits as well, but that's about the Andrew. What song's that? Heart of Stone. Well, what it was with the last time, he did this very fancy instrumental version, and then there was a band, and then it was pretty much forgotten, you know. And then back in the late 90s, 97, I believe it was, there was a band called The Verve, and they did a song called Bittersweet Symphony, and they took a bit of that, you know, a bit of his instrumental and made a song out of it. But there was a lot of legal trouble, you know, who owned the rights to the song, and... Andrew Oldham, you know, he said, you know, you've been caught out. It's my song, you know, so which is fair enough, I think, really. So, yeah.
You know, another standout page here, the Swinging Blue Jeans. This is great, right? So Much in Love. And what the song was, wasn't released until 2019. Tell me about that. That's fascinating.
I love the Swinging Blue Jeans. Ray Ennis and Ralph Ellis, you know, absolutely fantastic band. I've just got to say that the Swinging Blue Jeans are my second favourite Liverpool group. You know, they're just below the Beatles. I absolutely love the Swinging Blue Jeans.
I got to say something. I love them so much. I did an interview with Ray Ennis coming in from Liverpool, one of my favourite interviews, right? The guy's a legend. I couldn't give him so many accolades. I love the guy. And, you know, some of their songs are really stand out, right? They were fantastic.
That was a great interview, yeah. But anyway, So Much in Love, it was written by Jagger and Richards, and it was a very small hit for a group called the Mighty Avengers. They were from Coventry in England, and they were managed by Andrew Lou Oldham. But anyway, the just 2019, about 3 years ago, a BBC version come online and on download sites on a Swinging Blue Jeans, and it's fantastic. But I wrote to Ralph Ellis, who was the original guitarist, and he can't remember. He can't even remember doing the song. He confirmed it's him singing. It's his lead vocals on it, but he can't even remember doing the song. He was so surprised that it came out. So.
Now, I'll tell you what, if you go and see the Swinging Blue Jeans videos, there's some really great stuff where they're dressed up like in French shirts and they do these songs, and it blows my mind. They're just so underrated, but so up there. I put them up there with the Beatles. I just do.
Oh, me too. Me too. You're No Good. You're No Good was one of the best records of 1964.
I totally agree. And to tell you, that is my favourite song. That is my favourite song by the Swinging Blue Jeans. That's how great that song is. And I really appreciate someone who knows their music and picked it straight away. That is my number one favourite song of the Swinging Blue Jeans.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, yeah.
How they put that together, that should have been a number one around the world. Easy.
It should have. They never went to America, unfortunately. I can't remember why. I think they was booked for, Western Supermare or something like that, and the manager said, "No, you do these gigs. You don't do the Ed Sullivan Show," which was such a mistake. So they're not really known in America, and that's very sad. Yeah, so
that's sad as well. Now, is there any Australians that covered some Rolling Stones songs?
Yeah, I've got some in there. I can't remember the names offhand.
That doesn't surprise me.
I've got 500. I can't remember who was from Australia, but there are some. Yeah, I should have made a note. I apologise, but yeah, but there are. Jimmy and the Boys. They was like a new wave group. They did Get Off of My Cloud around about 1981, 82, and they did a very unusual new wave version, Get Off of My Cloud.
Now, tell me from the book, right? Tell me three of the greatest cover versions that are your three favourite from the book.
Yeah, sure. Let me have a think now. Sandy Shaw, I mean, she did, just pop records, really. But in 1969, she did an album called Reviewing the Situation, and she did very unusual things. She did a Led Zeppelin song with it, but she also did Sympathy for the Devil. And it was fantastic. It's not something you'd expect Sandy Shaw to do, but it is fantastic. That's one of them. Two more. Let me think now.
Can you also tell me what Chris Farlow did? What song did he do?
He had a big hit with Out of Time. The version of Out of Time. I mean, a lot of people think it's Chris Farlow's record. And interestingly, the Rolling Stones, they toured this summer. They did a European tour. And for the first time ever, they started singing it on stage, Out of Time. That's the first time the Rolling Stones have done it. So even Mick Jagger's starting to recognise that's a great song. People want to hear it. So
Chris Farlow, did he do one of the Rolling Stones songs in the book?
Yeah, Out of Time. He did. I believe there's about seven of him in the book. Ride On Baby, Think. Yesterday's Papers. Did a great version of Yesterday's Papers. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, it's on the cover. Yeah. A third one. Let me pick a third one. The Searchers, Take It or Leave It. It's a song from the album Aftermath. What it was, the Searchers were actually on tour in Australia with the Rolling Stones supporting them. And their career was slightly in decline. This would have been early 1966. But they got quite friendly with Mick and Keith. And they said, "We got a song that's good for you, Take It or Leave It." And they took it, basically. But they did a great, great jangly version of it. And I think it's so much better than the Rolling Stones version. It just suits their style better, the harmonies and the jangly guitar. Yeah, Take It or Leave It, the Searchers, which is on the cover as well. Yeah, so, yeah.
Now, when you look back, and I'm just saying, and you look at the way they've written their songs, right, Off the Hook is my favourite, unknown Rolling Stones songs, because the song is so great, and they did it on the Tammy Show, right, in America.
Yeah.
That song, to me, is just, you hear the riff of the song, and it's just so great.
Oh yeah, I love it. And interestingly, there's a in the book there's a Beatles connection because the Pete Best combo they did a cover of Off the Hook, a great cover actually. Pete Best. It wasn't released until about 1981, unfortunately. It wasn't released at the time. But yeah, but the Pete Best combo did a. You wouldn't expect that Pete Best to cover the Rolling Stones, but yeah, did a fantastic version, actually.
Hey, what about Jimmy Nicol? Remember when he left the Beatles after he did the Australian tour? He did a song called Husky. It went nowhere.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah, bless him.
Yeah. Oh, it's unbelievable. Now, I want you to tell everybody where they can get the book now, all the links to buy the book.
Well, basically, Amazon, it's available worldwide on Amazon, Amazon UK, Amazon.com, Amazon Australia, Amazon Brazil, Amazon Netherlands, yeah. Just go to your local Amazon site and you'll get it, yeah. But if not, just Google my name, Peter Checksfield, and I'll help you. You know, just email me and I'll help you get it if you can't get it, so, yeah.
Right, the name of the book is Undercover, 500 Rolling Stones cover versions. That... You must hear. Go out and get it. What a fantastic book. I haven't put it down from the time it arrived at my house. And I'm just telling you, you just write some fantastic books, Peter. And there's so many books that you've gone that can go on the internet and check them all out. But that one that you did about the American TV show, that was fantastic, right? Shindig. That's a fantastic book.
Yeah, that did really well. Yeah, that's one of my best.
Would you write one on Ready, Steady, Go?
No, someone actually wrote one, Andy Neal, about a year or two. It's actually a fantastic book. I'm proud of my books, but I've got to say, his book was the book of the year when it came out. It wasn't my book, it was that. It was a fantastic book. A great big book by Andy Neal on Ready, Steady, Go. Yeah.
You know what I really like, Peter? I love that fantastic story that you tell me about the guy at the TV station, the BBC, and he hid tapes and he taped stuff and made copies and no one knew about it.
Yeah,
and they wiped everything and this guy kept stuff. That's that.
Yeah, I mean,
fantastic. Like on that guy.
Oh, yeah. Well, for instance, some of the Rolling Stones clips. There's clips of them doing Get Off My Cloud on Top of the Pops and The Last Time on Top of the Pops and a few others. Actually, I've got to say about the Top of the Pops appearance of the Rolling Stones during the last time, in the audience dancing is Georgie Best, the footballer. You look very closely, there's Georgie Best dancing with one of the top models of the day in the audience.
Now, listen, can you tell everybody your links for yourself, your page and your books? Apart from Amazon, where are you on the net? Give them whatever site, whether you've got a website or what you've got.
Yeah, just peterchecksfield.com. Yeah, just look, Google my name. Peter Checksfield, and you Google it, it'll come up. So, yeah.
Peter, it's been my pleasure. I always love having you on the show and talk. And when you write the next one, let me know and we'll do another interview.
Will do. Right. My pleasure too. Thank you.
I just love you. You're just the greatest. And so much knowledge about music freaks me out because, you know, as I said, I've been brought up on the UK and the US music scene all my life. First generation baby boomer, except as I said, in 67, the monkeys were it for me. In 1964, I'm 6 years old. I'm too young for the Beatles, as you can appreciate. But it doesn't matter where you come in life, what group it is, you always end up at the Beatles.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. this 500 Rolling Stones cover versions book, I did consider doing one on the Beatles, but there has been three or four books like that on the Beatles. I am considering, but someone will probably nick my idea now, doing 500 covers of John Lennon. So that could be an interesting book. Yeah, because, so.
Thanks again, Peter, for being on the show.
Thank you. Take care.
See everyone.